Good evening and welcome to it. This is yet another episode of Chess and Wine, and I'm Adi Bele coming back to you with some interesting chess developments, interesting chess news from in and around South Africa. Today we're speaking to Miss Babalwa Rubusana. Yes. Babalwa Rubusana, hailing from the Western Cape, from a township called Gugulethu, a chess development agent. Yes, a chess activist, something I would identify with myself, because I think she's doing something that I've also been known to do for a while, and I think she's doing it on the large scale. And obviously she's an award winner in the Western province, a leader of many, the founder of the Gugulethu Chess College, Ms. Rubusana. Good evening and welcome to Chess and Wine. How are you?
I'm good, Eddie. How are you?
I'm all right, thank you. I'm glad to finally get the chance to speak to you. We've been hearing a whole lot about you, your achievements, your developments, and I think your activities are feeding into this chess community of South Africa. I think you are one of the, the grassroots activists of this chess that people are fighting for at the top. I think without you, they wouldn't be fighting for anything at the top. There wouldn't be anything.
Yeah, that's true.
Definitely.
Hey, it hasn't been easy, Edgy.
I can imagine. It's been a journey. Tell us, just share us a bit about your journey, please. Let me give you a chance, please.
Thank you, Eddie. Thank you for the warm welcome.
You're welcome.
And, I was saying to my mom yesterday that, hey, because yesterday I was called that I'm nominated again for another award this coming Saturday.
All right. Wow. And
who nominated me? When? How? I didn't even know that. And I was like, okay, I'm going to. And I actually have organized my kids to go to a tournament, so I was also ready to go to that tournament in Bonneville.
Yes,
right outside Worcester here in Cape Town. Tomorrow there's a tournament, and Saturday there's a tournament there. So I registered 22 kids, hoping that I was gonna go there, but now I have to ask my other coaches to assist me and go with the kids because I need to attend the and I was saying to my granny, just by the fact that I'm nominated for an award again, it shows that I'm flying into that direction.
You are moving in the right direction. Yes, definitely. You are doing things right.
Eddie, the journey started when I was actually working at SARS when I started teaching kids chess.
All right.
And then I left my job and resigned, and just decided to change my chess club to a chess college. Mm-hmm. So I registered it as an NGO. So I decided to start a career in chess.
Okay.
Because I saw I was giving my time and my passion into the wrong direction.
Which was SARS.
So, SARS.
Yeah.
People, my passion is with kids. It's with development, you see. But besides that, Eddie, the journey hasn't been easy. My work is amazing, but the cherry on top is the fact that I'm free. I don't even have a registration fee. You see, so all the work.
You had to give up your source of income for this, though. Like, there must have been a bigger drive than just a passion for kids, and it's chess, it's not any other sport. So I don't know, I mean, I feel like there's a deeper reason behind it that you maybe might share with us, because I don't think it's just passion for kids. I mean, you have 2 hours, 3 hours after work. You can give for kids, to kids and all that. But to resign...
I know, it's not just the passion for kids.
You're at South African.
It's the passion for the game.
Passion for... You see, now... Okay. So why
passion
chess?
For the game.
Why chess, and why do you think that it was necessary? What moved you to even resign, to leave your job for chess development?
Okay, Eddie, it started, okay, firstly, I started playing chess when I was in primary school.
Yes.
And back then, in the 90s, it was not like today. Everything was free, I'm assuming. Because now, each and every tournament, you have to pay. So back then, I didn't have the support that I have now. I think if I had that 100% support, I would have been somewhere else. Because I live in Gugulethu. Not a lot of people know chess.
Yeah.
Some people, they say chess is chess. So I have to start from the fact that chess, this is chess, and then this is chess.
So chess is chess, like the chess we're sitting on.
No, chest. Like,
oh, chest.
Chest.
Okay. Chest. All right. Okay.
Call it chest. So, what moved me is, okay, I also wanted to be a grandmaster one day.
Mm.
It's just that challenges and growing up, I didn't have, because I was a very naughty kid. I would come back from boarding school and my mom would say, you've got an email, you were invited, there's a tournament. She gives me money, I go to a tournament. Sometimes I don't even go to a tournament, and then I'll come back and say, hey, I lost 3 games and I won, and I didn't even go. And then she doesn't even know if I went or didn't go. It's just, she thinks she's assisting me and supporting me,
yeah.
Which is, she does. But then, so I told myself, when I was teaching my brother, because my mom has only 2 kids, me and my brother,
yes.
And we are 21 years apart.
Mm.
So I was teaching my younger brother, he was 3 back then, how to play chess. And then I had a son, then he wanted to play chess, and then I had a daughter, and then they also wanted to play. So when my brother was in grade R in Luzuko, I was still working at SARS.
Yeah.
The principal called me to say, hey, can you just come and teach the other kids here what you're doing?
Mm.
So I said, okay, I will come Saturdays. Then I opened a chess club. And then after a club, that's when I decided, okay, because now there's a lot of kids that are coming, the friends. And then I decided, okay, let me just start a chess club.
Yeah.
And then after the chess club, I just had to think out of the box, because our chess college, Gugulethu Chess College, we're not only looking for the best chess players.
Yes.
Okay. But we know by learning chess or having the skill, there's a lot of things that you will gain.
Yeah.
And like our kids, like they lack concentration, a lot of them.
Yeah.
Especially in our townships. So they just gain a lot of things, and at school, when we enter school, we don't just teach a certain group of kids. We teach the whole kids, the whole school.
Okay.
Like imagine a school in a township or in a rural area where each and every child knows how to play chess.
Yeah, because the thing is, that's what I'm thinking. Like, when I'm asking you, like, the bigger drive to do this. Because, I mean, I can understand giving kids sport as a pastime for activities. It's one thing. But giving them chess is another thing, because you're sort of shaping their thinking. You're shaping their future. You sort
and,
of, yeah.
That... trust me, I had kids that were deemed... kids that they used to say
Learning
they're very career. Slow.
Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, they wanted to take them to a school of skills.
Yeah, yeah.
I started teaching them chess.
And
trust me, they are A students now.
And the results just changed. Because you just structured what their thinking.
What I decided to do, I decided I'm gonna get math tutors and language tutors.
Yes.
Okay. So I also created a academic assistance department.
Mm.
So what we do when we the first hour, we take out our books, because I know you've got homework, you've got an assignment, you've got an essay, you've got a project. And then the first hour, we do our homeworks, yeah. Our academics.
Yeah.
And then after that, we do chess. And then in that way, at least, we're just trying to mix and incorporate chess in the curriculum, and maybe one day.
I mean, that's a because I don't even know. I mean, because Anzel Lobenshu was from FIDE. She's doing chess in education. So I don't know if they are doing just chess in education. They're trying to get chess into schools only, or they are doing what you're doing. Because again, what you are doing is just, it's brilliant. Bringing the academics with the chess as well. Just kind of, I don't know, balancing things up. But now I wanted to, are you doing only primary schools, only secondary schools, or both? Primary and secondary schools.
Well, Eddie, we mostly focused on primary schools because that's where the root is.
Yeah, foundation.
And then, yes, and then in high schools, it's not actually compulsory.
Yeah.
We only take the ones that want to join in high school.
Yeah, yeah.
Because like, we have a lot of high school kids. And then we also visit churches. We visit other organizations that work with kids and or actually old age homes. Wherever there's a child, if you see kids on the street doing nothing, we give them chess. I've created something. It's called like chess pop-ups.
Yes.
I wanted to make chess a street game. Yes. Because you see here, everywhere you go, if you go, kids are playing soccer, they're playing netball. But you don't see any child playing chess in Gugulethu. So
yeah, I mean, that's another thing I have as well. When you walk around the streets, you see maybe some kids playing cards, or they're playing dice, or they're playing any other board game on the street somewhere in the corner, but not chess. And then I walk around, I just wish I could hear.
I started creating that during Corona because we were not allowed to have gatherings.
Mm-hmm.
So I would supply all my kids with my chess boards.
Yes.
And then I'll tell them between 12 and 2, go outside and play chess. And then I'll go around. If you're playing, I'll give you something like a sweet, a snack.
Mm.
As long as you're playing outside the house. So I know between 12 and 2, everybody's going to be outside their house playing chess.
Because
they know I'm going to be going around. Because we're making sometimes. We'd go in front of your house, we put our tables there, we start playing. We know the kids from your area are going to come, and then we start teaching them.
Pushing
and then the following week,
promoting we go to accessibility another. To the beautiful game. But then now, who supplies you with the chess sets, chess equipment? Where do you get the equipment from? Where do you get the support from?
Okay. Hey, it was that easy at first.
Yeah.
Hey, Eddie.
For. When did you start? When did you start doing it? And then when did you start getting assistance? When did you start working with the kids, doing the chess on your own? And then when did you start finally getting assistance? And the recognition, obviously, of getting awards. Yes.
2016, I started teaching kids while I was still at SARS, working for the government. Mm-hmm. And then I met a friend of mine. He was a colleague there, Dr. Zulani Buba.
Okay.
I think he was God sent. He was also working at SARS then. He sponsored me with 3 chessboards.
Alright, that's a good
because he loved writing.
Yeah.
And then that's how I actually started mass participation, because I would put 1 chessboard and 10 kids. 1 chessboard and 10 kids. So I'd do 30 kids with just 3 boards. And then after that, he assisted me in a lot of things, and he was the only sponsor up until I decided, okay, let me just resign and create a chess college.
Mm.
Okay, the idea was a chess college whereby you come and learn chess and we develop you.
So your award,
actually chess college.
You got an award. Tell us about the award that you received. What was it for? Where was it from?
The awards.
Jeez.
The first one was from Chess Western Province.
Mm-hmm. That's your region, right?
For sport. Yes.
Yeah.
Sport Community Builder of the Year. Hello. Sport Community Builder of the Year.
Yes.
And then
Sport Community Sport that was Community last Builder year. Of the Year. Wow. All right.
Wait. Last year, 2022.
No, but I mean, listen to the weight of it. Listen to the weight of this thing. You were the Sport Community Builder of the Year in the Western Province, previously in the Western Cape, where chess is like, and chess in that province is flourishing. Sorry, please forgive my phone. chess in that province is one of the high, like in the whole country. I think the one province that is leading in terms of chess development is chess. It's Western Cape. So now I think Western Province must be one of the most active provinces as well, like in terms of all other sports even. So now when it's my goodness, I don't know. So I just, for myself, I just needed to sort of put that. Hey, are you with me?
Sorry about that.
No, it's all right. Yeah, no, I was just trying
to. My phone is heating up.
Slightly put that into perspective, because the Sports Community Builder of the Year award in the Western Cape, in the Western Province, is a big thing, especially in a province where sport is such a big thing. Is if you look at all the competitions or all the, what do you call these things, Gambit? Everything that is happening in sport, in sports in the country, Western Province is always at the top, which means there's a lot of community builders in sports to make that possible. Because whenever there are nationals in sports, Western Cape always comes up there, right? So what you're doing must be a very big thing. No. I for me, I think it's a big thing. So yes, please go ahead. You were saying Sports Community Builder of the Year. What does that come with, though? Did it make things easier afterwards? Was the access to more support from then on after the first award?
My phone is heating up. Eddie, my phone is heating up. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. You're saying your phone is heating up.
Yeah, it's heating up and it keeps heating up. For saying it's very hot. Anyway, last I also received another award this year in May.
Yes.
This one was from DCAS. It was also Sport Community Builder of the Year, but yes. Now it was not from chess, it was from All Sporting Code.
So what's that? It's
Cape Town Sport Awards. It was Cape Town Sport Awards.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah, jeez.
And then again, this time it's the provincial awards again. So that's why I'm saying, just because these awards are showing me that I'm actually moving into the right direction.
Yeah, this is awesome. But now that's why I wanted to ask regarding this awards. After receiving this awards, do you feel like that things are changing? Your access to opportunities for your kids, for yourself, your access to maybe some form of support in terms of resources is changing, is improving as you get the awards, or are things still the same, hustle?
No, actually, Eddie, after the awards, there was a lot of journalists that wanted to share my story, like you. And then I actually got a few sponsors.
Yes.
Like the people that were saying, and then the other ones, can you assist with the registration fees? What do you want? So I've got one sponsor that I've actually asked for stipends, because what I want is stipends. Yes. I want to pay my officials.
Yes, yeah. Because that's become stable.
So one sponsor actually said, okay, we can assist with stipends.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a blessing. One, like, I think we're moving, we're going up, because at least now I don't have to struggle a lot with registration fees or transportation and feeding the kids, because I feed the kids out of my own pocket.
Okay.
Since their parents will tell you, listen, I don't even have bread money. You want chess money? I don't even know what I'm going to eat tonight. So. I have to, these kids depend on me to actually play chess and continue moving, because now we've been winning and we're going to the nationals.
Are you, you see now, again, because I also wanted to check on the opportunities that the kids are getting. So fine, you're providing them with the skill, because I mean, I also had some instances where kids would excel from the lower levels. But then now when it's time for them to move to the higher levels, or to move to whether it's provincials or nationals nationals, especially nationals and international events, where now fans are required, it becomes a big challenge. It's a challenge that
I know.
Yeah, and it frustrates some of the kids. You even lose, or you risk losing some of these kids to the streets because they're like, oh, why are we doing this? Because it's more stressful. So, have you experienced any such? And are you still, or at least now you have some form of assistance?
Eh? Like, for instance, now I've got a sponsor that assisted me with registering 20 kids for the tournament that's happening this coming weekend.
Yes.
And another one, there's a girls tournament that's happening again the following weekend. They also assisted with that. So I do have sponsors that actually assist with the registration fees and traveling and sometimes, but I have to, of course, tell them in due course.
Yeah,
and they do. I think the social media assisted me a lot.
Yeah,
the analysts assisted me a lot.
All right, so now that's a good thing. So at least if the kids are still getting opportunities, at least those deserving, because not everyone is playing competitively, right? Others are playing recreationally. I think that's what you were mentioning, that you are trying to offer this opportunity for others who just want to play for the benefits of the game, just enjoying the game, and obviously, and those that want to play because they are competitive, they are very good at the sport. But then now again, I mean, now I'm speaking as someone that's been that's traveled a similar road. Like, now I used to have fights with organizers in events, because I mean, we needed the recognition at the beginning, right? The parents actually back home, like when you take your kids from Msokwaba, like a township like Msokwaba, which is in many ways similar to Gugulethu, and you take them somewhere out of town or to town to play chess, and they win, they come back with medals and trophies. You wanted to show in some of the newspapers, you want people to know about it, and obviously they're usually, in our case, the winners would be shown in the following weekend. There'll be obviously a newspaper article with the winners holding their trophies or wearing their medals and so on and so forth. But when my kids won, I don't know if maybe it was because we were sort of imposing or into other people's territories and would come back with the medals, they wouldn't show them in the newspapers. So that's what I used to fight with. So that's something I used to fight against. So it's like, every time, like, why would you not? How could you show a picture of somebody that came 10th when this is the person that came first, and you don't even show a picture of them in any article? There's no mention of them in all.
Exactly.
What are some of the challenges that you have faced? Like, obviously, you have to represent the kids. You have to represent your township where you come from when you get to. What are some of the struggles, some of the challenges that you have encountered that are worth speaking about, even if they're no longer happening? What if you see things that you had to go through?
Like in terms of the media?
Not necessarily. Like, it could be anything. It could be with the organizers, with the officials, because with the, I don't know, maybe you, okay, what's different is that you are coming in and you are bringing, I don't know, because you see where I'm coming from.
Okay, let me tell you.
Yeah,
they know me here in the Western Cape that I believe in mass participation.
Yeah,
so each and every tournament, league, I would bring 40 and more kids.
Nice. Yeah.
Like a lot of kids.
Yo.
So they always tell me, Babalwa, you cannot bring more than, if it were 20 kids, at least have 3 coaches with them. And I just bring a lot of kids. Like, I've got a lot of, I think I've got more than 300 kids. And who am I going to choose?
Oh, my goodness. Okay.
I've got a lot. I've got toddlers. Like, the youngest is 3 years old.
Okay, all right.
And the toddlers, wait, the toddlers, the 3-4 year olds in kindergarten, what I do, I just teach them the movement, the name of the pieces, and yeah, how to pack. And then when they get to grade R, we start taking them to tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
So It's,
no, yeah, no,
they
no,
will
no,
come and say,
operating on a way different scale than I have ever seen. I doubt if there's anyone in the country, like, I'm gonna be like, issue a challenge now, if there's anybody that is doing more than you anywhere in the country. You can't, no, honestly, you have over 300 kids that you're teaching.
Now, you know why, in Gugulethu, what I do, I've got a school in Luzuko Primary School. Yeah. I've got 107 kids there. Mm. Another school, Little Primary. I also have like 50-something kids. Bonga Primary, I've got more than 75. Vukukanya Primary, I also have. I also have a disabled school.
Yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, I'm not looking for the best chess players. And I have kids that are very good. They're not mentally disturbed. They just mentally disabled.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a limp or something, but they're very good chess players. I just have, and then during the weekend, those kids come and the other kids that do not attend those schools, but are part of our chess college. So we would have, so every tournament I bring a lot of kids, and kids from the township, you know, most we come from the township, black kids. They always
excited about,
yeah, in trouble.
They always, I mean, they're free. Sometimes. We get free, obviously. I mean, we understand. And we mustn't try to restrict them too much. As long as they don't break things, they're fine. They must enjoy themselves.
So, that's why I don't really play on tournaments and league, because I don't have my mental set, my mental, my mentality now is not on playing.
You can't,
because if a child there would pick up his hand, I would actually want to know what's happening there. And then sometimes I would be called to say, hey, they're jumping the fence.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to run, and oh, my kids. And
jeez,
it's so just a lot of challenge.
What were some of the biggest, I don't know, like the highest achieving kids from your college, from your Gugulethu Chess College? Who are some of the highest,
okay, my kids,
and how far did they go in terms of representing? Were they representing?
They represented the school in the Western province, like for the province. They represented their schools in the province, yeah, in the Western province. And they received provincial colors.
Nice, okay.
Like, yeah, about 10-year-olds. 12-year-olds, 14-year-olds, and high school kids as well. Very good players. So, but you know what I do? When I've got a new school, I take my younger kids to come and coach those ones, because I think they understand better kids when they're taught by other kids. I also have private school.
That's peer education of sorts. Yeah. That's peer.
I also have a private school.
So, are the private schools also not paying, or at least they're paying?
No, of course it pays me good. I can't be fooling everyone.
No, private schools have to pay, because even if you tell them they don't pay, they want to charge the parents, so they must pay.
They pay. They pay me good.
No. Mm-mm. All right. No. Hey. Yo, Babalwa, your work, man. Like, I was impressed to see again that you have kids from the age of 3.
Yeah, my kids, the another challenge that I've received this year when I AD is space.
Yes.
It was space. The space I was using for the weekend. We were asked to move out. I don't know why.
I was assuming that you were doing it on at a school, but now obviously you're doing it on weekends. So you had a different space instead of a school. You had a space for what? For the college now.
During the week, I'm in between school.
Yes.
You see.
Yes. So everybody comes.
It's a mobile college. Yes, we go to different places. Like, for instance, I've got a coach in another school and a coach in another school, and then I'm also with them, we assist each other. It's just officials. And then during the weekend we were gathering in another school.
Yeah.
So now we didn't have access to that school that we were using during the weekend.
Yeah.
So now I had to think out of the box and it was not easy. So I had to make sure that I register the kids every weekend for different tournament, and then we use that
tournament
event as training venue. So we've been doing that for a lot of for months until we received something to actually. Yeah, so it was very tough. It was very challenging.
Are you saying you now have the space, or you're still looking for a space? Have you sorted that?
No, we have problem. Space now. We are actually moving. We don't need space now. We have space. Okay, we do need space, like a permanent space, because my dream is actually to build my own chess college, like a structure where I could say this is the actual chess college structure.
Yeah.
So I'm in a process of that. Yes, hopefully I'll get a sponsor that's going to actually build that chess college for me.
That's awesome.
But for now, we're a mobile college. And it's not easy. Because it's really not easy having to have a lot of kids.
But then now, what material are you using? Because I know, obviously, when you're dealing with kids, you're dealing with different types of personalities, different types of characters and all of that. But now, for training, for coaching, I was prompted to even develop my own chess manual. Then obviously I had to give it to my coaches, because I also had like 10 schools which I was doing a problem. That was the time when I had funding for it. So I had like 10 schools, and but obviously it didn't last for too long. I think we did it for a period of about 2 years with 10 schools and 5 coaches, and we reached to a lot of kids. That's why we had to develop a chess manual, and it worked. So what material are you using, or at least to equip your coaches to you? Are you saying your coaches must at least use their own chess experience, or do you provide them with certain standardized material for coaching? How are you? Yeah, let's get to the technical part. How are you getting to that? How are you handling the technical?
So what happens is, I do have Obawali. Obawali used to teach me chess, so now he assists me in teaching these kids chess. So sometimes we would meet at his Claremont Chess Club, or he would come to Gugulethu. He's 83. He's the best. And then my coaches, once a week we meet up for online sessions. Okay, the school we do have access to labs.
Yeah.
School computer labs.
Mm-hmm.
So I would prefer a coach to use their own skill, but of course with guidance and communication with me, because I have a different style, and we don't have the same level of chess and the same level of coaching.
But
I do have campaigns whereby I would organize a campaign for us chess coaches. Maybe we would get an international chess coach, someone that's actually doing the same thing that I'm doing, but just try and copy or borrow one of or two of how they actually do things. We're not stealing the idea, we're just borrowing it.
It's the good of the game, the good of the players and so forth. I also wouldn't mind anybody stealing my thing, but yeah, I see what you mean. I see, yeah, because it's like learning from someone and obviously applying it in your own way from your own situation. That's basically what it is.
And I've got coaches like the one coaches that deal with toddlers. So it's mostly the other players that are not really good at chess,
but
love chess.
But they understand it. Even.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. And because I've noticed some kids, they're not really good chess players, but they're great at coaching and explaining the basics of chess.
Yeah.
You see, so I take those ones and put them with my toddlers, my kindergarten kids. Teach these kids how to pack, how to move, and all that. You see? And then I've got coaches for beginners, I've got coaches for advanced players, and then I've got a coach for experts and advanced players. And it's just do things differently, because firstly we have to have money. Sorry about that.
Yes.
We have money because everything costs money. And we have time. So what we do Monday until Thursday between the school, and then Fridays we meet up and have meetings and just talk about how the week was, the challenges we got and how we can tackle them. And then Saturday we meet up again for everyone. Besides the school.
What's the end game? Like, what's the, like, what is the completed, I don't know, the full picture look like for you? Like, obviously, you're still, the full puzzle completed. Like, the end game, like, where you would feel like, now I've done it. Now it's all, well, I mean, obviously, you have plans, and after a while, you feel like, okay, I think it needs a bit of improving. You plan, obviously, to do things in a certain way, and later on you realize, all right, I can add this now to it, and so on and so forth. But then now you probably do have a picture of what you your ultimate desire for this vision is. What is it? What's your ultimate goal with Gugulethu Chess College, or even with everything that you're doing?
Okay, the aim is to have, firstly, I want to, like now, my goal for 2024, employment. I've polished the far, is to create employment. 2024 is creating employment through chess. So it's basically education and development through chess. So you can be anything you want to do, you just do it through chess. So the aim is to build chess colleges. The aim is to just share chess. Everybody must play chess, must know how to play a game of chess. Just know the game.
Just like people know soccer, right?
Everybody knows soccer.
So everybody must know chess.
Like now, in one school, I'm teaching grade R up until grade, like I'm teaching the whole school.
You must also
teachers.
Can't you come up with a plan where you teach the teachers as well?
Yeah, the teachers.
Yeah.
And you know, the teachers are lazy. There's another teacher that was like, isn't this gambling? I'm like, no, ma'am.
But that's why she needs chess. Because at least chess will sort of shape her. She didn't have chess growing up. You must you must be understanding to people. I'm sorry. But yeah.
So the aim is to have chess. Every child must know how to play chess. Everyone must know how to play chess.
Sustainable development for through chess. I love it.
Yeah, education and development through chess. Yeah.
Yeah, education and development through chess. Beautiful. Wow.
At first, I wanted to give more skills because I realized that. Okay, our kids, when they grow up, because especially in our townships, either you're a dropout or you have. So if you're a dropout, you'll have grade whatever. Great. If you pass your matric, you only have matric and you don't know how to continue or what. So I also created Gugulethu Chess College, and the education and development through chess is to give these kids skills. So while I'm giving them a skill for chess, I find a math tutor, a language tutor, an IT specialist to assist and give them another skill, but through chess.
Awesome.
So maybe in future we'll have other skills that we'll give the kids through chess.
Here's another thing. You have over 300 kids. And instead of sending those kids to tournaments every now and then, do you have an arbiter? Because I think you need an arbiter in your team. Do you have arbiters in your team? Because at least that way, sometimes you'd be organizing your own tournament. I mean, the thing is, when you have 300 players, you don't need, because with me, when I had, I think it was a time where I had over 200 players in obviously the 10 schools that I was working with. And then I made sure that I started a league where every weekend they'll be playing a league game, like for 3 months. Because, yeah, and obviously try to get it rated. Because when you have
I
them,
didn't
then, at least they've got enough people to compete with. Because I think the number one reason why we want to take kids to tournaments is for them to go and compete with others and at least see their, obviously, their shortcomings and improve and then obviously get to, and all of that. But, yeah, improve, a reason to go back to, what am I saying? To the book. And, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, go back to the drawing board.
I didn't tell you that, honey. I created my own cup.
Yes.
Okay. And my nickname is Bash. So kids call me Sis Bash. Bash. Yeah.
All right, Bash.
Like a big Bash. Yeah. So I created a tournament, a cup, my trophy. It's called the Bashman Chess Cup.
Bashman.
So they play the Bashman. Yes. Yeah. They play for the Bashman every December. All my kids. They represent the schools as well.
Nice.
So last year I had 200 kids from 12 different schools.
Mm.
They were playing the Best Matches Cup. And I do have an orbiter, a very good friend of mine, Andrew Talmarcus. He always assists me.
What's his name?
So Andrew Talmarcus.
Andrew Talmarcus. Isn't he the
Andrew Talmarcus.
Isn't he the president of...
he's a friend of...
He's the president of one region that side, ne?
Of inside Chess College, yes.
Yes, okay.
Inside, he's a very good friend of mine.
All right, Thomas. I think he was also the president. I think he was the arbiter. Was he the chief arbiter for the Cape Town Chess League or something?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Awesome.
Yeah, he's.
You see what I mean?
Yeah. So every December, he assists me with the tournament for my own club, for my own kids.
Yeah.
So we do have our own tournament. We do have our own tournament where all our kids participate.
That's a beautiful
thing. And Easter's, every Easter tournament, every Easter's, we have an Easter weekend tournament in Gugulethu.
For your kids?
So,
beautiful.
Yes, for my kids.
Exactly.
More than 200 kids.
You see, that's what I mean now. Instead of people seeing you coaching or training every time, they must watch and see the competition as well happening within Gugulethu. Awesome stuff.
And once a week, once a month, we have
say again. I think I lost you there. But you have what? Once a month?
We have.
Oh my goodness! She has left the meeting. Babalwa has left the meeting because of her cell phone that is busy dying on her. But my goodness, what this lady is doing is such amazing work, and I'm feeling so inspired. She's gonna make me think about going back and teaching chess, but I mean I don't like that anymore. I told a lot of people that they should, that who should be now doing the teaching. But yeah, man, like, yeah, it's quite beautiful what she's doing. Let's see if she doesn't come back. If she comes back in the next 5 minutes, if she comes back in the next 5 minutes, we'll get to wrap up the interview together. But if she doesn't, this has been the awesome interview with Babalwa Rubusana, the award-winning Babalwa Rubusana from Gugulethu, representing obviously the Western Province region in the Western Cape Province, as obviously the community builder through chess. I've been telling you, this is a lot that you can do with chess, and she's been doing it. There's a lot that you can do with chess, and she did it. She done did it. Oh my goodness. Yeah, so we're so proud of what Babalwa is doing, and we hope everybody else gets inspired to start doing something similar. Go to the schools that they obviously in their communities and do something a little bit. Do something. Just one school. I started with one school, Luzuko Primary School, and that's where I gained my confidence in coaching and training. And then later on went on and on. You see what I mean? But yeah, anyway, it's already been a long time. Let me not steal your time. I'm not a time thief. Thank you for watching. It's been a great evening. Comment below. Let us know what you're doing to develop chess. Like I had this challenge this one time where I asked everybody, please teach one person, at least teach one person how to play chess. Each one teach one, right? That's how we grow. That's how the sports grow. Yeah, Babalwa is teaching 300. Go figure. Hopefully she gets the other award as well. And whenever a chess player wins or a chess coach wins an award in sport and everything and anything, chess is winning. Chess stays winning. This has been Chess and Wine, and my name is always and still Eddie Pila. Good evening, and thank you for watching. Remember to subscribe. Ooh, we're at 397, and we're going to 500 subscribers. Mwah. I mean, Chess is growing. Goo goo. Bye bye.